A study asked 141 participants to name the emotions that they get from music. There were dozens of emotions named. Love was ranked number one, but surprisingly, sadness was the eighth most experienced emotion on the list, suggesting that listeners frequently seek out sad songs. Why would people enjoy subjecting themselves to something that can cause them to feel emotional pain? Centuries of music, books, plays, and movies have shown that in an aesthetic context, getting melancholy over works of art can feel good. Music uses timbre, tempo, and tonality to express what sadness feels like in our bodies, listless, downfallen, sometimes even numb. These acoustic elements elicit sadness through emotional contagion and conjuring up visual imagery of sad scenes. On a more cognitive level, the association between sad music and somber occasions can also trigger nostalgia. An ironic observation is that the majority of listeners get pleasure from somber music. As they say, where there is pain, there has been love. Sadness can remind us of happiness. The paradox of sad music puzzles researchers. Recent work into the popularity of sad songs suggests that it's the experience of being moved that actually confers the pleasurable reward. The factor of movingness lets the emotion of sadness contribute to liking. Any negative emotions experienced during music listening are the safe kind, meaning that the circumstances behind the lyrics don't personally concern us, and the trouble ends when the song is over. Sad songs also give us a companion during rough times. In a 4-minute song about pain or unhappiness, a singer can accompany us to the edge of despair and then turn around and walk us back to safety. This connects us to others and helps us feel less alone. If we are receptive to it, then sad music amplifies how moved we feel overall. Having feelings is good for us as members of society because it reinforces the bonds to one another and reminds us that we are human. Does sad music simply arouse empathy, or does it actually cause us to become sad? Well, sad music actually causes sadness in roughly 1 out of every 4 listeners. And this is mediated by individual and cultural differences. Women are shown to be more likely than men to experience sadness while listening to music, and musicians are more likely than non-musicians to enjoy sad songs. Age also plays a role. Turns out that children typically do not like sad songs. Those adults who like sad songs rank higher in the traits of introversion and openness to new experiences, and they may tend to be more empathetic. Sad music can be cathartic, and it helps listeners to manage or experience negative emotions that need addressing. It walks with us down into the well of our own psyches. Listeners choose sad music when they're alone, in emotional distress, feeling lonely, feeling introspective, or, and this is odd, in contact with nature. One study found that the response to sad music was stronger when participants listened to it alone than in a group. In general, sadness in response to music is pleasurable when there is no actual reason to be sad, when it is aesthetically beautiful, and when it produces psychological benefits. It has also been suggested that sad music may be simply more beautiful than music that conveys happier emotions. Sad music often expresses deeper issues, and it could be perceived as being a more intimate form of art. Now, composers and songwriters need to be cautious and bear in mind the old saying that any donkey can kick down a barn, but it takes a human to build one. Pulling the listener down with a tale of woe is easier than pushing the listener up with joyful music. Historically, the latter is much more popular. Just look at Pharrell Williams and the global mega hit Happy, for example.